I want us to look at Galatians. I just finished preaching a series of sermons through Galatians at Coral Ridge that ended 2 weeks ago. And I start the Sermon on the Mount tomorrow and haven't even started preparing my sermon, so please pray for me. But I preached an 11-part series through the book of Galatians. And it was interesting because I preached through Galatians probably 10 years ago. And when I decided to preach through Galatians again, it was because I had been reading Galatians with brand new eyes over the last 5 years or so. And I went back to some of my old sermons that I preached, and I couldn't believe that I said some of the things that I said to these poor people. I really couldn't. It's like I missed the entire message of the book. Somehow I turned the message of Galatians, Paul's letter to the Galatians, into a call to perform for God. Now, how you can do that, I have no idea, because that's the exact opposite of what Galatians teaches. And so this time around, I was greatly changed and encouraged and transformed by what God was teaching me. And so I want to, this morning, look at Galatians chapter 5. I'm going to look at verses 16 to 26. Before I read those verses, I thought about something this morning that kind of builds a little bit on what I said last night that I want to share with you. For whatever reason, I woke up this morning and I was reflecting on when my wife fell in love with me. It was 20 years ago. We've been married for 18 years. We both met when we were non-Christians. And I was a complete mess. I mean, a big mess. I mentioned last night, I think it was here that I mentioned that there's a difference between, Christian bad and non-Christian bad. I was, like my Uncle Franklin, for instance, was Christian bad. He, you know, drove motorcycles and smoked cigarettes. And I remember him being on Jay Leno one night, and then after his book about him being a rebel, his autobiography came out, and Jay Leno said something like, well, I've read this, and clearly you used to be a rebel, but I couldn't find anything bigger than the fact that you used to smoke cigarettes, drink whiskey, and ride motorcycles. And so then Jay Leno said to the entire crowd who was there, he's like, how many of you have ridden motorcycles, drank whiskey, or smoked cigarettes? And everybody raised their hand. And Jay Leno said something like, that's the definition of Christian bad, okay? I was non-Christian bad, all right? And my wife, who wasn't a Christian but entirely more responsible than me, fell in love with me. And we dated for about a year and a half, and I was a complete jerk the entire time we were dating. Promiscuous, and she knows all this, by the way. But when she was standing next to me, she was my girlfriend, but if she wasn't around, I was on the prowl. I mean, that's the kind of scumbag that I was before I was a Christian. And not only did she fall in love with me when I was a complete train wreck and a mess, nothing attractive about me at all, but she stayed in love with me in spite of the poor way that I treated her. And then God saved her and God saved me, and we got married, and of course, you know, the rest is history. But I was reflecting on that this morning, on who I was and where I was when Kim fell in love with me, the kind of person I was, and she stayed in love with me. And that just makes me want to go home. It really does. I mean, it makes me want to go home. It enlarges my heart for her and makes me want to go home. And I thought, this is precisely the power of the gospel. When you think about where you were when God saved you, what you were when God saved you, who you continue to be, and God continues to love you in spite of who you are or fail to be, it does something inside that makes you want to serve Him and love Him and follow Him and go to Him and run to Him. And that's why I can't understand anybody who would conclude that God's expression of unconditional love and amazing grace to train wreck sinners like you and me would in some way propel lawlessness and disobedience. I'm like, that doesn't even trans, that's not even real in our human relationships, as I mentioned last night. That doesn't even make sense in our human relationships. When I am at my worst and Kim continues to give me her best, it makes me want to love her more. And that's the power of the gospel. If Kim were to wake up every morning and look at me in the eye and say, you better love me today better than you loved me yesterday, okay? I am expecting you to love me more today. I mean, at some point you'd be like, just get away. I can't do it, okay? I can't be for you what you're expecting me to be for you. Instead, she just keeps loving. And it's that continuous stream of Kim loving me that makes me wake up in the morning and reflect on her love for me and say, I just cannot wait to get on a plane at 2:30 and go home. And I just want to kiss her and tell her I love her and all of those things. So don't fall into the trap of believing that God's smile over you because of Jesus when you are at your worst and continuing to mess up is going to discourage you to follow his lead. It doesn't. It does something inside of you that makes you love him more and want to follow him more. So that's just sort of a cap off on. I was reflecting on that this morning and said, I want to share that with the guys. Okay, Galatians chapter 5, beginning in verse 16. These are those verses where Paul describes the difference between the works of the flesh and the fruit of the Spirit. And he says, beginning in verse 16, but I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the desires of the flesh are against the Spirit, and the desires of the Spirit are against the flesh, for these are opposed to each other, to keep you from doing the things you want to do. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. Now the works of the flesh are evident: sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, rivalries, dissensions, divisions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and things like these. I warn you, as I warned you before, that those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. But, verse 22, the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. And those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and its desires. Let me pray for us. Father, by your Spirit, I pray that you would give us great insight into these verses, and that as a result of meditating on this truth, you would set us free. And it's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen. Paul summarizes everything he wants to say in this letter in Galatians chapter 5, verse 1. Galatians chapter 5, verse 1 is a summary of Paul's goal in the book of Galatians. And he says there, for freedom Christ has set us free. Stand firm, therefore, and do not submit again to a yoke of slavery. Martin Luther, whose commentary on Galatians is probably the most important book written on the gospel that I can think of. And he called Galatians, as many of you know, the Magna Carta of Christian freedom. His life was turned upside down as a result of this letter that Paul wrote to the churches in the region of Galatia. And it is chapter 5, verse 1 that really does summarize everything Paul is trying to accomplish in this letter. And what follows chapter 5, verse 1 is a description of what a genuinely free life looks like. Because we can talk a lot about freedom, and Paul certainly does in the first four chapters. He theologizes about freedom, he defends freedom, he speaks glowingly about what Jesus has done to secure our freedom and our natural tendencies to go back to the yoke of slavery that once burdened us. And we can talk about those things, we can debate about those things, we can theologize and philosophize about freedom, but it still begs the question, what does a genuinely free life look like? Freedom on the ground, What does freedom on the ground actually look like? How do you really know that you are living free? And he gives this great description of what a genuinely free life looks like. A genuinely free life is faith working itself out in love. And that's what he says in verse 6. In verse 6, he says of chapter 5, "For in Christ Jesus," this is such a key verse to our understanding of the gospel, "for in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision nor uncircumcision counts for anything, but only faith working through love." It's an amazing thing. We don't deal with the circumcision problem today, but the circumcision problem back then represented a view of the Christian life that put a lot of weight on what we contribute, what we do, obligations that we must fulfill. And so Paul says, in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision, what we do, uncircumcision, what we fail to do, counts for anything. What matters most, what matters at the bottom is faith working itself out in love. And he shows how the demand of the law actually prevents this. Okay, here you've got the goal. What matters most in the Christian life, life on the ground, is faith working itself out in love. And then he makes the point that the law actually prevents this because the law turns you inward. All right, so you've got freedom on the ground looks like outward expression, okay? Love for others. Because he first loved us, all right, we are now empowered to selflessly serve other people. We are empowered to love other people. And in doing so, fulfilling the law that Jesus said when they asked him, trying to trick him, which commandment is most important. And he summarizes all the Ten Commandments by saying, love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, and love your neighbor. Okay? Love for God, love for neighbor. And Paul shows that the law prevents this outward expression of love because it actually turns you inward. It makes you selfish. The law focuses all of your attention on you. How am I doing? Am I making it? How is my spiritual temperature today? Okay, that's what the law does. The law becomes a measurement by which you turn in and evaluate how you're doing. All right? And when you're so fixated on you and you're obsessed with how you're doing and you're obsessed with your own spiritual temperature, there is way too much spiritual narcissism in the church today. Way too much. And we justify it in 1,000 different ways. We actually think it's a God-honoring thing to take our eyes off of Christ, the author and finisher of our faith, and to fix our eyes on ourselves. And we do it under the banner of we are, you know, these are good phrases, but we attach definitions to them and then we abuse it. You know, we're pursuing holiness, we're practicing godliness, and like I said last night, what ends up happening very subtly is the focus of the Christian faith becomes my individual life, all right? And so now it's not so much about Jesus and what he's done as much as it is about me and what I need to do. The law convinces me that the goal of life is getting better, okay? That's what the law does. When you live a life that is driven by law, and I don't have the time to develop all of this through Galatians, it's there, trust me. This is what Paul's primary argument is. But the law convinces me that the goal of life is getting better. This is the problem, and you know this to be true. The more I obsess over the need to get better, the worse I actually get. Because this is what happens. When the goal of life becomes getting better, I become neurotic. I become self-absorbed. I become narcissistic. I begin thinking about me more than I think about you. I begin thinking about me and how I'm doing more than I do Jesus and what he's done. You know, the great New Testament illustration of this is when Jesus is walking on the water toward his disciples in the boat, and he summons Peter to join him. And Peter, having never walked on water before, with fear and great fear and trepidation, gets out of the boat in faith, gets out of the boat, and begins walking on water. And he was doing just fine when he kept his eyes on Christ. But when he looked down to see how he was doing, he began to sink. And there are a lot of people inside the church today who are sinking because they are obsessed with how they're doing. And they think in some twisted way, we think in some twisted way, that this is a God-honoring thing to do. When we are constantly going in and evaluating and taking our temperature and, you know, fixated on getting better and improving, we think that that glorifies God. It's never honoring to God to take our eyes off of Christ, to look at ourselves, ever, okay? It's never, ever honoring to God to take our eyes off of Christ, the author and finisher of our faith, and to focus on ourselves, because when we do this, we become obsessed with ourselves, and this is what happens as a result. We fail to see the needs of others and serve them. In other words, faith doesn't work itself out in love, and we miss it, okay? The gospel reassures me that I am free from the slavery of needing to get anything, because everything I need in Christ I already have, and this frees me to spend my life giving. So Paul shifts gears in chapter 5. For four chapters, he talks about essentially what we are free from. And then beginning in chapter 5, he begins to talk about what we are free for. This is what, when we are free from this, free from slavery and death and sin and ourselves, when we are free from this, when the burden has been lifted off of our shoulders because Christ declared it is finished, it's a done deal, and now if you are a Christian, you live your life under a banner that reads, it is finished, okay? The tent of God's grace has plenty of room for our mistakes, thank God, because we're making them even right now, whether you realize it or not. That's why I don't understand. I was talking to a group of guys last night, and we were talking about this very thing. And I said, you know, people are afraid. People inside the church are so deathly afraid of Romans chapter 8, verse 1. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. And everybody wants to qualify that. Okay? They want to qualify that. What that means is that if you are in Christ, when you blow it, you aren't condemned. When you make the same mistake over and over and over and over and over again. And if you don't think you do that, ask your wife, okay? I mean, the same things my wife was telling me 20 years ago, she's still telling me, all right? And the list has grown, all right? It hasn't gotten smaller, it's gotten bigger in various ways, because we become more acutely aware of our sin, we become more acutely aware of our condition, and therefore we become more acutely aware of how desperately we need Jesus. Okay, so as a result, we become scared of this, therefore there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. And I want to say, like the Apostle Paul, that's our only hope. That's our only hope. I mean, if our disobedience and mess-ups as Christians warrants condemnation, we are all screwed. Okay, every single one of us. It is our only hope. Don't dare fight against the one thing that you need most, which is that declaration. That's what Paul keeps saying throughout the book of Galatians. Why would you go back? Why? You are abandoning your only hope. I mean, that you don't dare submit yourself again to a yoke of slavery. I mean, you're going back. Why in the world, once you have been relieved of the burden to get it done on your own and to make it happen and to secure for yourself all of the meaning and value and worth and validation that Jesus has secured for you, why would you go back to that? It's a life of slavery. And then he begins to describe here what a life of slavery looks like. So this is the goal. He's showing us what we are free from, okay? And then beginning in chapter 5, he shows us what we are free for. And he basically says this, because Jesus has done everything for me, I can do everything for you without needing you to do anything for me. That's freedom, he says. Blessed self-forgetfulness. That's freedom. And so often today, the way that we speak about sanctification even, or Christian growth, or discipleship, or accountability, or whatever, does not encourage or engender self-forgetfulness. Okay? You ever been a part of those accountability groups? I have. There are good accountability groups and bad accountability groups. Okay? And the bad ones are really bad, because all they do is basically encourage you to obsess over your sin, all right? And there's plenty there, all right? I mean, it's like a bottomless pit down there. And, you know, the groups I'm talking about where you sit around with, you know, a group of friends once a week, and the goal of the group is to uncover layer after layer after layer after layer of sin. And at least this, I can remember this happening to me. It's almost as if you uncover everything that you're conscious of, but, you know, your friends keep probing as if to say, this actually makes me feel good because finding something bad in you makes me feel better about me, okay? And I can remember being part of groups where we thought we were doing a very holy thing by sitting around for 59 minutes talking about all of our sin, and then we spent the last, and then, well, let's see, 57 minutes talking about sin, 2 minutes going around the room rebuking everyone else for their sin, and then 1 minute of closing prayer, okay? And what became the focus of those groups was not the Savior of sinners, but the sin, all right? Now, I'm not suggesting we don't talk about sin. Obviously, we do. However, when the focus becomes our sin and not our Savior, we get worse, not better. Okay? It engenders deeper slavery, not greater freedom. So blessed self-forgetfulness is a good phrase to describe sanctification. I must decrease, he must increase. And any kind of description of sanctification that's going to take you inside and fix your eyes on you is totally different than what the Bible describes. Less of me, more of him. Not more of me and less of him. Okay? Blessed self-forgetfulness. You know, C.S. Lewis said it well. You'll know you meet a genuinely humble man not when you find a man who speaks less of himself, but a man who doesn't speak about himself at all. Okay? Well, that's the goal. Okay? It's the goal of sanctification is love for Jesus, which requires death to self and weaning us off of ourselves and how we're doing and whether or not we're making it and all of those things. And this is what Paul describes. We are free to love unconditionally because we have been freely and unconditionally loved with a love that has, in the words of Robert Murray McShane, neither brim nor bottom. All right? My daughter Jenna is 10. And she's very emotional right now, and has been for the last 4 months. And I'm trying to find out for my wife why this is so. Okay, she's been there before; I haven't. The boys present their own challenges to us, but Jenna is hilarious. She can do no wrong in my eyes, and she'll say something. You know, she's beautiful, and she's I'm her hero right now. It's not going to last much longer, so I'm enjoying it while I got it. But she's so emotional, and she will blow up for the smallest things. It's ridiculous. Okay, I'll be sitting on the couch and watching a game or something, and Kim will say, "Jenna, it's time to do your homework." Oh, why? I hate school. I hate this family. I don't even want to live anymore. And I'm like, seriously? I mean, it's just a small request to do your homework, okay? And she'll go, oh, and she'll lose her temper and stomp away out of the room and slam her door and go into her room, okay? Now, she does this like 14 times a day, all right? And then she'll come out like 5 minutes later, and she'll go to Kim, and she's like, "Mommy, I am so, so sorry. Please forgive me. So, so sorry. Will you forgive me?" And Kim will say something like, "Honey, I'd like to forgive you, but this is the 12th time you've done this today, and it's hard for me to believe that you're actually sincere. You mean you don't forgive me? Oh my gosh, I hate this family. And she'll run back in her room, okay? That's when dad usually steps in. And I go into her room and she's just on the floor, dramatic, spread out, just, you know. And I'll say, honey, come here. And I mean, she really is. I know dads are very biased toward their daughters, but I mean, she really is beautiful. Just, I mean, I'm in big trouble in about 4 or 5 years. She's a model. I mean, like a bona fide model. Okay, I don't know how I feel about this. I'm going to put the kibosh on it probably in a couple years, but right now she's making a lot of money. She has more money than all of us. It's unbelievable. She heard Kim and I talking about needing to pay for something the other day, and we just couldn't afford it, and we hear her from the other room go, you guys can borrow some money from me. I'm like, we might actually do that. She's absolutely beautiful, and so that makes it even more difficult to get angry with her because she's just gorgeous. And so I go in her room, and I'll say, honey, you know, what? Come here. What's the matter? You know, I'm sorry for my sin, and I go to mom, and she just doesn't forgive me. And I said, you know, do you know why? I mean, it's hard. I struggle with the same thing too, Jenna, because you make the same mistake over and over and over and over again, and we believe that you're sorry, and we forgive you, but when you make the same mistake 5 minutes after you just said sorry for it, it's hard. It's not very convincing that you're being sincere. And I said, that's how mom and dad will probably fail you for the rest of your life. But let me tell you about one who you can go to 10,000 times. 10,000 times. You make the same mistake 10,000 times. And you say sorry 10,000 times. And you go to him 10,000 times. He forgives you 10,000 times. His love has neither brim nor bottom. There is no exhausting of God's grace. While our sin reaches far, God's grace reaches farther every single day. It is that amazing, and it is that hard to believe. We just don't believe that. God's love has to end somewhere. I have to be able to exhaust it. At some point, yes, I'm a Christian, yes, I believe, and yes, I have struggled with the same thing, you know, for 25 years, and I keep going back to him and asking him to forgive me, and it's just so hard for me to believe that he actually does, because I just asked him for forgiveness for the same thing an hour ago. Thankfully, God's forgiveness of us is not dependent on our sincerity or our re-upping our commitment to get it done. This time, I'm really going to lick the problem. God's forgiveness is dependent on what Jesus has done for us. And so it's inexhaustible. Inexhaustible. And I know, because this is me too. I say these things and you hear these things, and there's such a big part of us that goes, I don't believe that. And that's dangerous. Okay? Is it dangerous for me to tell Jenna, you can make the same mistake 10,000 times? If you are in Christ, and you will, okay? You will. And you can say sorry 10,000 times, and God will forgive you 10,000 times. To a regenerate heart, that makes her go, not, oh, this is great. I can go do it 10,000 times. It makes her go, God is so good, and his love is so big. Why in the world would I ever run away from him to anything else? That alone actually helps us, in a sense, get better. So, in these verses, Paul continues to contrast, as he has in the previous verses, a law-driven life with a gospel-driven life by describing what each produces. And he says, the law produces works of the flesh, and the gospel produces the fruit of the Spirit. All right? In verse 19 through 21, he makes it very clear that a law-driven life produces the works of the flesh. He begins in verse 16 and 17 by describing the battle that rages within the Christian. And he says things like, the spirit and the flesh are against each other, and the result of this battle is that we are kept from doing what we want. All right? Very reminiscent of what he said in Romans chapter 7. The things that I want to do, I don't do, and the things that I don't want to do, those are the things that I keep on doing. Oh, wretched man that I am, who will rescue me from this body of death? Okay, that is the internal struggle and battle that goes on inside Christian people. And I think it's important to point out that the Christian life is experienced as a both and. Okay, now let me explain what I mean by this. In God's eyes, from God's vantage point, our identity is an either or. We are either in Christ or outside of Christ, under the curse of the law or under the promise of the gospel. Okay? But the Christian life is experienced as both and. All right? And this is very important. You know, I grew up hearing the analogy of, you know, we got a good dog and a bad dog inside, you know, and when you feed the good dog, the bad dog shrinks and gets weaker, and when you feed the bad dog, the good dog shrinks and gets weaker, and so the goal of the Christian life is feed the good dog, all right? That's the goal. And I understand that analogy because that's the way it feels. That's the way we experience life. We do it all the time. We feed bad habits and we get worse. We feed good habits and we get better. Okay? It definitely feels like there are two dogs inside of us. That's the way we experience it. And so while on the one hand we can acknowledge that that is our daily battle as Christian people, we don't want to make the mistake of believing that we have two natures inside of us, okay? Because what we want to affirm is that from God's vantage point, we are new. The old is gone, the new has come. We were once dead, and now we're alive, okay? That is our core identity. We are in Christ. We are no longer slaves, we are sons. But our experience of the Christian life as a result of remaining sin is this battle that wages within. And Luther described this by saying that we are, of course, as you know probably, at the same time justified and sinful. That's the way we experience the Christian life. From God's vantage point, we are justified. From our vantage point, we are justified and sinful. We believe, we don't believe, we go back and forth. The things that we don't want to do, that's what we do, and the things that we do are the things we don't want to do, and all of those things, but we have to keep in mind that our core identity is that we are Christians, Christ ones, in Christ. Sons, not slaves. Okay, so that helps when we're making our way. That's why J.I. Packer said famously that every time a Christian sins, he is momentarily suffering from an identity crisis. He's forgetting who he really is in that moment and what he really wants at his remade core. All right? Because we're giving into this battle that's taking place. Another way to describe this internal war is, as I mentioned, the battle between unbelief and belief. Okay. Hold on a second, please. Whew. Is it hot in here a little bit? Yeah. Some of you guys were mentioning that on Twitter, that my back wasn't the only one sweaty last night. It was very encouraging to me. I felt less like a slob. Unbelief, he makes clear in verses 19 to 21. Unbelief manifests itself. Who just turned the lights down? Thank you. That's awesome. That's going to help me probably. Unbelief manifests itself in the works of the flesh. What does unbelief look like on the ground? Okay, what does unbelief look like in life? And he describes these works of the flesh, this laundry list of things that I just read a few minutes ago. So let me talk just a minute about temptation, okay? When we are being tempted to sin, there is a deeper temptation happening under the surface. Now, this may come as a shock to you. But temptation has more to do with belief than it does behavior. Every sin, every temptation to sin is at its root a temptation to disbelieve the gospel. Everyone. I don't care what the surface temptation might be, greed, lust, envy, or any of these other things that he mentions here. There's an under-the-surface temptation, and it's always the same, and it has been since Genesis chapter 3. Go back in your mind to Genesis chapter 3 at the moment where Adam and Eve said, okay, I'll eat. They were being tempted to disbelieve in God's providential goodness, in his gracious provision, what he had created them to be and to do, and they took matters into their own hands, deciding for themselves, I can make it on my own better, and the thought of being independent is much more attractive to me than the thought of being dependent. They believed, like the world is trying to convince us of every single day, that increased independence equals freedom. The gospel says just the opposite. Increased dependence on Jesus equals freedom. And they believe that. So ever since Genesis chapter 3, that's been our struggle. Every temptation to sin is a temptation to disbelieve the gospel. On the surface, as I said, the temptation might be lust or anger or greed or self-pity or revenge or having to win or whatever. But the only reason we give in is because we think it will satisfy our deeper hunger for meaning and freedom and validation and respect and happiness and all of those things. Okay? The works of the flesh, in other words, are the fruit of the problem. The root of the problem is our refusal to believe that everything we need and long for we already possess. Now, this is a somewhat embarrassing story, but it's happened to me on numerous occasions. I have, at various times, believed that I have misplaced my keys, okay? Or, more specifically, I have believed that someone in my house has misplaced my keys, all right? So when I'm late for a meeting or I have to get out the door and I'm looking for my keys and I can't find them, I begin barking at everybody, okay? Honey, where are my keys? You saw my keys? You're always picking up things when I just leave them on the counter. You ever do that? You know, I put a drink on the counter, I go to the bathroom, I come back, the drink's in the sink. I'm like, honey, I was gone for 30 seconds. I mean, seriously. You know, you're a little obsessive compulsive. I mean, honey, where are my keys? You're always picking up things, blah, blah, blah. I haven't seen your keys. Okay, kids, where are the keys? You know, Gabe, now my 17-year-old, is driving. God have mercy on everybody driving the streets of Fort Lauderdale. Gabe, did you have my car last? Where are my keys? Jenna, were you playing with my keys? I bark and I bark and I bark and I bark. We have animals in our house. I bark at them. Maybe they took the keys. There's animals in my house that I just discovered last week. My family conspires and keeps these things from me because they know I don't want any animals in my house. Any. We've got a, 200-pound Shih Tzu who has welts on his belly because it drags on the ground when he walks. He's missing teeth. I bark at him. Thomas, did you take my keys? Okay. We have a guinea pig that I just found out about 2 weeks ago that they've been hiding in a corner. Maybe the guinea pig took the keys. We have turtles. We have a bird that doesn't shut up. I told my wife, I said, don't ever leave me in this house by myself with that bird. Ever. I'm convinced. It's so annoying, man. I try to sleep and it wakes up bright and cheery at 6:30 in the morning. Can't stand that bird. We have turtles, we have frogs, whatever the case may be. I bark at everybody. Someone misplaced my keys and I'm late for a meeting. Where are they? And this has happened more than one occasion. I go to my room one last time to look for my keys, and I just so happen to stick my hand in my pocket, okay? In my pocket. And lo and behold, there are my keys, okay? And I feel like an idiot. Yeah, I've just yelled at everybody in the house. And we laugh at that, and it's silly. We should. But do you realize that's how most of us live our lives? We're desperately searching for something we already possess. We're frantically searching for something we already possess. We're barking our way through life, frantically trying to find the keys. And God says, they're in your pocket. Everything you need and long for in Christ, you already possess. Relax. Rejoice. It's finished. This is what's going on in the moment of temptation. In the moment of temptation, we are being tempted to secure something for ourselves, something that we already possess in Christ, meaning, validation. And whenever I talk to guys who struggle with lust and pornography and that sort of thing, what becomes very clear is that it's not simply naked bodies, okay? There's something going on down deep, a thirst for control, a longing for affection, a longing to be served, a longing to be respected, you know, all of those things. That's the under-the-surface temptation that gives birth to the surface temptation of visiting websites you shouldn't visit, okay? Or greed. You know, I talk to guys who struggle with workaholism and getting more, and it's never simply about the stuff, okay? Getting a bigger house or getting a nicer car. It's always, there's an under-the-surface longing, like people will respect me more. I will validate my existence if the people around me think I'm important. And the way that I can get the people around me to think I'm important is that they believe I'm successful, okay? So all of these things that he describes in this list are surface issues that are birthed by under-the-surface longings, okay? So this is why we give in to temptation. We're desperately looking under every rock and behind every tree, searching for something to make us happy, something to save us, something to set us free. So when Jesus was asked, like I mentioned last night in John chapter 6, verse 28, what must we be doing to be doing the works of God? And he answered, this is the work of God, that you believe in him who he has sent. He was making the point that unbelief is the force that gives birth to all of our bad behavior and every moral failure. Okay? So Luther said it this way. He's so quotable. Luther's the most quotable guy who ever lived. So concise and compact in his sentences. He said it this way, the sin underneath all sins is the lie that we cannot trust the love and grace of Jesus and that we must take matters into our own hands. That's a killer quote, okay? The sin underneath all sins is the lie that we cannot trust the love and grace of Jesus and that we must take matters into our own hands. So this is what the law says. This is the pressure that the law puts on you. The law says you don't have what you want, so it's up to you to get it. And this turns us inward and makes life a passionate pursuit to fix ourselves and to satisfy ourselves, which is why the law prevents chapter 5, verse 6. If the Christian life is, if what matters in the Christian life, according to Paul in verse 6 of chapter 5, is faith working itself out in love, you see how the law turns us inward. It makes life a passionate pursuit to fix ourselves and to satisfy ourselves and to find meaning for ourselves and all of those things. The law says it's up to you. Make it happen. Get it done. And when we buy into that, we end up living life trying to make it happen, getting it done. We are trying to live our lives securing for ourselves what we can never secure for ourselves. And so the law says you don't have what you want, so it's up to you to get it. And I become so obsessed with having to get what I think that I need, I don't have time to love and serve you. Okay, I become fixated on what I need. And therefore, I don't have time to love and serve you. And the irony is, this is Paul's great irony here, that a law-driven life actually leads to law-breaking. That's what he's saying here. You want to live by law so that it's all up to you to get for yourself what only Jesus can provide, then it looks like the works of the flesh. That's what the works of the flesh is. It's self-indulgence. Well, why do we self-indulge? Because we're trying to save ourselves. We're trying to justify ourselves. We're trying to free ourselves. We're trying to validate ourselves. We're trying to make something of ourselves. We're trying to gain happiness for ourselves. Whatever, however you want to say it, that's what we're doing. And so the law turns us inward, and it actually leads to law breaking. Out for ourselves, we become self-indulgers of the flesh. So that's a great irony. Believing, if we want to live a law-driven life, there is one guarantee that we will become indulgers of the flesh. If we want to live by that rule, that it's up to us, we become indulgers of the flesh. Now, there's a huge contrast here. A gospel-driven life, on the other hand, produces the fruit of the Spirit. And he mentions these in verse 22 to 26. In contrast to a law-driven life, a gospel-driven life produces all of these things that he mentions in verses 22 and 23. And verse 18 clearly says that life led by the Spirit is not life under law, and this means that the fruit of the Spirit are not produced by the law, but by the gospel. All right? Now, this may seem like a throwaway sentence, but it's super important for us to understand, because typically the way I grew up thinking about the fruit of the Spirit is this. I need, Christian growth is this. I need to go out and get something I don't have. So I'm not a very, for instance, loving person or patient person or, you know, whatever else he mentions here. And so in order for me to grow as a Christian, I have to go out and get what I don't already have. And what Paul says here is Christian growth does not happen by going out and getting what you don't have. It's coming to a deeper realization of what you already do have. And as you grow in your deep awareness of what you already do have, that everything I need in Christ I already possess, this happens. It's fruit, which means it grows naturally. It begins to develop. That's why I can look over the course of my life and compare myself now at 39, almost 40, to the way I was at 21 when God first saved me. And it's just been this progressive development of these things. Not because I have been, in a sense, actively pursuing these things, but God's been actively putting me to death. And as a result, these things begin to grow. So you become more loving, more patient. I'm far more patient with Jenna because I'm older than I was with Gabe when I was a 22-year-old dad. Far more patient. Isn't parenting much more fun when you're older than when you're younger? When you're younger, you're worried, you're concerned, you don't want them to make the same mistakes you did, so you become legalistic, overprotective. And as a result, interestingly, my oldest son is our most difficult. Now, he's not anything like I was, thank God. And most 17-year-old boys are probably difficult. But he's just like me, which scares me to death on one hand. But, you know, I did everything, and so did Kim, did everything we could to keep the reins on, you know. We read all the books, and we followed all the formulas, and we did everything, and we were so anxious that, oh my gosh, if I spank him at the wrong time, he's going to end up in prison. You know, if I love him when I should whip him, he's going to end up divorced. Parents do this. We think that whatever mistakes we make are going to turn our kids into mass murderers. And now, you know, you've done it for a while, and now parenting Jen is so much more fun, because of that. Well, what he's describing here really is that, the fruit of the Spirit is not produced by the law. Go do it. But it's produced by the gospel. And he says that so clearly. Verse 23, the second part of verse 23, when he says, he describes the fruit of the Spirit, against such things there is no law. Now notice the difference between works of the flesh and fruit of the Spirit. It's very intentional on Paul's part. Works are something we do. Fruit is something done for us, which produces something in us. One is active, the other is passive. Okay? It's very important to understand. When we talk about justification, we rightly talk about something being done for us. When we talk about sanctification, we fall into the trap. Jerry Bridges points us out in his excellent book, Transforming Grace. But when we talk about sanctification, something happens. And we think sanctification is not something done for us. And yet, that's exactly, justification, sanctification, glorification is all of God's work for us. Okay, that's why Paul says in Romans 8, that great golden chain of salvation, those whom he foreknew, he predestined. Those whom he predestined, he called. Those who he called, he justified. Those who he justified, he glorified. And Michael Horton says, you'll notice very easily that there are no human fingerprints on that golden chain. Okay? What God began, he will finish. All right? From beginning to end, salvation, past, present, future, is a work of God. It is something done on behalf of sinners like you and me. So the fruit of the Spirit is not something we achieve by our hard work. In other words, Paul's not being prescriptive here. It is something we receive because of Christ's hard work for us. He's being descriptive. As you come to a greater understanding of Jesus and what he's done for you, this is what you'll begin to look like. This is what you'll begin to look like. This is what a free life looks like. A life rooted in the gospel of grace. This is what begins to happen in you and through you, the fruit of the Spirit. And the contrast between the works of the flesh and the fruit of the Spirit is really the difference between the effects of the law and the gospel. Life under law turns us away from others and into ourselves as we try to keep its demands to find life on our own. That's what the law does. The law, life under law, turns us away from others, turns us into ourselves as we try to keep its demands to find life on our own. The gospel, on the other hand, declares, proclaims this: I don't need to save myself. I don't need to defend myself. I don't need to justify myself. I don't need to fix myself. The gospel announces that while I was unlovable, God showed his love to us in the death of his son for us. And the result of being loved is that love grows as naturally from us as fruit grows on a tree. That's his point. All right? Paul's all puts it like this: our works of love are the fruit of the belovedness that the gospel engenders when it grasps us. The Christian lives from belovedness to loving action. Unselfish acts always flow out of being on the receiving end of unselfish love. Okay? So, faith working itself out in love. This is not a my life for me. The life of slavery is a my life for me posture. The life of freedom is a my life for you posture. Blessed self-forgetfulness. Everything I need in Christ I have. So I don't need, because everything I need in Christ I have, I can do everything for you without needing you to do anything for me. Okay, that's freedom. That's absolute bona fide freedom. That's what freedom on the ground looks like. And that only happens, unselfish love for others only happens as a result of our growing awareness of the unselfish love that we have received from God. Let me kind of play this out as I conclude here. About 2 weeks ago, I think it was, maybe 3 weeks ago now, I came home from 3 days of travel, and my speaking schedule while I was away during that time was so busy that I didn't have time to work on my sermon. It's like deja vu, actually, this weekend. And I get home, my flight was delayed and all of that stuff, and I always have someone travel with me, so I'm sort of stressing to this guy that I got to get up tomorrow morning. This is on Saturday. I'm like, I got to get up tomorrow morning and preach, and I haven't even started working on my sermon, and I'm stressed. It's a terrible feeling, as some of you know, to, as the day gets older on Saturday, and things are busy, to go, I've got to preach tomorrow, okay? And so I finally get home about 9:30 at night, all right? 9:30 at night. Now, I had done some work on the plane, but I walk in the door. I've been gone for 3 days. My wife, first of all, the boys have like 5 friends over, okay? I'm like, everybody get the heck out of the house, all right? This is not conducive at all to concentrated study and preparation. So I was like, everyone get out, all right? Jenna's still awake, sitting on the couch, and I'm like, what in the world are you still doing? It's time for you to go to bed. Kim's like got a glass of wine next to a bottle of wine. looking at me going, it's about time. So I'm like, Jenna, let's go to bed. Put Jenna in bed. Love you. You're great. Boys, everybody leave. You can go sleep out tonight. You don't even got to go to church tomorrow. Just get the heck out of the house, okay? I go in my room. I was like, honey, I give her a kiss. And I said, I got to go. I really got to go to work. I got a sermon to prepare. And so I go into the bedroom and I close the door, signaling to the world, leave me alone. All right. And about 5 minutes later, Kim comes in, you know, with a glass of wine, sits in a chair, and she's like, crosses her legs. She's like, so, you know, tell me about your weekend. And I'm like, this is what I'm saying inside. Woman, I don't have time to tell you about my weekend, okay? Do you understand the pressure I'm under here? 9:30, 10 o'clock at night, I got to preach tomorrow morning, and I've only got maybe a third of my sermon done. Okay, so this is my description. Well, it went well. I got to meet some great people, and I spoke two or three times, and, you know, some people loved it, and some people hated it, and, you know, my flight was delayed, and now I'm home safe, okay? That's it. Basically, that's it, okay? And then, you know how it is. They ask you questions. Women love details. I hate details, okay? I'm like, it's a great trip. Home safe. Good night. You know, she like, oh, but tell me, what did the air smell like in Myrtle Beach? I'm like, you know, so I give my 30-second version of my four-day, you know, being away. And then she says, well, let me tell you about my weekend, okay? And I'm like, good God, have mercy on my soul. I told this story, by the way, on Sunday morning at Coral Ridge when she was there, and she laughed. She thinks it's hilarious because it's so true. I had left on a Wednesday and came home on Saturday. So she starts, like, Wednesday after I got on the plane, okay? And I'm like, this is going to take forever, man. We got 4 days to go. You don't need to start with, now, so you got on the plane Wednesday, and as I was driving home, I heard this song, and I'm like, oh my gosh, man, high points, hit the high points, you know? I mean, big picture here. So she just begins, and in my mind, I mean, I'm stressing, seriously, man, I am stressing. I'm like, gosh, how do I tell this woman who I love, okay, to get out of the room and stop talking? How do I do that? And be sweet, all right? You guys are all laughing because you know this is totally true. When I was describing this church on Sunday morning, I mean, guys were coming up to me afterwards going, oh my gosh, you've been in conversations with my wife and me. I'm like, no, we're basically all the same. this is the deal in that moment. I was so focused on my need to finish a sermon rather than on her desire to catch up. All right? Thinking that my works, in a sense, this is life under law. Okay, thinking that my works, in this particular case, my sermon preparation, defined me, I focused inward. So I became very self-protective. This is what life by law looks like in a moment like that. You know, so much of my own validation, I can't get up on Sunday morning without something to give because so much of my identity is located in what people think of me as a preacher. So I got to go out tomorrow and perform, all right? And she's blocking me, okay? So life by law is I have to validate myself. I have to justify myself. I have to save myself. I have to generate for myself meaning and value and worth. And I'm forgetting that Jesus has already secured all of those things for me. And so I'm living in that moment a life by law. I'm trying to meet its demands. And as a result, I'm not thinking at all about her and her wanting to catch up 4 days of her husband being away and having to do everything by herself with all three kids. And she's tired and, you know, and I'm not thinking about her and, you know, just her desire to connect. I'm thinking about me. I am trying to satisfy the demands that the law has put on me. Go out and make something of yourself tomorrow. What are people going to think of you if you don't deliver the goods tomorrow? So the world gets shut out. I shut the bedroom door. Everybody get out. This moment is about me. If I don't have this time, I can't save myself. Okay? So knowing in that moment that I am defined by what Christ has done for me, namely the gospel, and not what I do, the law, would have freed me to give my time and love to Kim. All right? Knowing that whether I, you know, preach a dud and a doozy, the next day, or it's the best sermon I've ever preached. It doesn't matter. I admit this to the people on Sunday morning at Coral Ridge. I said, listen, you need to know your pastor's an idolater. And the only reason I say that is because you are too, and I'm thinking that by confessing my idols, it'll set you free to confess yours. So I say part of the reason I work so hard to prepare sermons and am here every week to preach sermons is because so much of my own sense of worth is dependent on you thinking I'm a good preacher. Now, I'd like to be able to say, I get up because I'm doing the work of God and I live before an audience of one and, you know, whether I eat, drink, or whatever I do it all for the glory of God. Okay? That's just, I don't. And I do it for the glory of me and it's, not exclusively. It's always mixed like he describes here, you know, and like he describes in Romans 7. It's always mixed, but there's a part of me that does it for that. I'm trying to secure my own identity and worth and all of those things. That's life by law. That's the law saying, do, do, do. And when I listen to that voice that says, do this and live, instead of the voice that says, it is finished, done, 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 I turn inward because I have to make it happen. Instead of turning outward, faith expressing itself in love, because everything I need in Christ I have. So verse 24 says that those who belong to Christ have crucified the flesh. In other words, we have died. And then verse 25 makes it clear that having been crucified and made alive by the Spirit, we are free to walk by the Spirit. So that's what this means. In the situation with Kim, I was acting like a live man fighting for life instead of a dead man giving it away. All right? The fight for life is enslaving, isn't it? I mean, in that moment, the tension I was experiencing and the frustration and the anxiety, you know, I was like, I gotta get this done and you're getting in the way and everybody's gotta get out. And I mean, it was just tense. It was enslaving. I was a slave in that moment. I didn't have control. I was frantic. And if you don't hear, I was acting like a live man fighting for more life instead of a dead man giving it away. So if you don't hear anything that I say, or if you haven't heard anything I said, this is it, and this is what I close with. Real freedom happens. Okay, listen, this is so important. Real freedom happens only when the resources of the gospel smash any sense of need to secure for myself anything beyond what Christ has already secured for me. All right, I'll say that again. Real freedom happens only when the resources of the gospel, everything I need in Christ I have, when the resources of the gospel smash any sense of need to secure for myself anything beyond what Christ has already secured for me. When we don't believe that, works of the flesh show up. We become self-indulgent workers of the flesh because we got to get. Real freedom happens when we know that when the resources of the gospel smash any sense of need to secure for ourselves what Jesus has already secured for us. When we believe that, we are set free. I don't need anything from you. Because everything I need in Christ I have. So now I can give my life away. I can spend my life going to the back instead of trying to get to the front. I can spend my life losing instead of winning. I can spend my life giving instead of taking. I can actually begin to live my life in the way that the New Testament describes, turning the other cheek, walking the extra mile, loving our enemies. That's impossible apart from the gospel. That only happens as I come to the deep realization that everything in Christ, everything I need in Christ I already have, so now I can live my life for you. Friend, or foe. Let's pray together. Father, help us to get this. Change us by it. I pray that like the father with the sick daughter, we believe, but help thou our unbelief. Spirit of the living God, Jesus said that you came to testify about him. And so I pray, Spirit, that you would tell us over and over and over again today in our deep regions of unbelief, it is true, it is true, it is true. The whole thing is true. And we pray these things in Christ's name. Amen.